Hello and welcome to the Science Fiction and Fantasy Marketing Podcast, the show where we help you establish your author brand, increase the size of your audience, and sell more books. I'm Lindsay Baroker, and I'm here with Jeffrey Poole and Joe Lalo. And it's just going to be us three this week. We're going to be talking about strategies for breaking out in 2017. And kind of, I think first we're going to talk about some of the lessons we've learned in 2016. And if we have time, we'll talk a little bit about applying the 80-20 rule to writing, publishing, and marketing. Something I just talked about in my blog, and for those of you who don't follow my blog, which I never post to, so you're probably wise not to follow, this will be hopefully a little more in depth on that idea. But yeah, it's been about a month since it's been just us, so do you guys want to have any news you want to share?
As for me, I've learned that we've talked about this in the past episodes, actually a few times, it's harder to promote book number 7 as opposed to just promoting a brand new book and a brand new trilogy. So I have started my 4th series and I'm on my accelerated schedule. So hopefully I can get this done in less than 2 months. So fingers crossed.
As for me, I'm about a third of the way through my foray into the Fallen Empire series. I've also got a couple of illustrated projects that are rolling forward toward completion / announcement. One of them is the speculated Book of Deacon children's book, which I haven't gotten an update on recently, but it's got to be pretty darn near done. And the other is a mysterious project that I've mentioned in the past called Weird Nothing, which shall remain mysterious because I really don't know if it's going to happen yet, but fingers crossed that it will. Other than that, it's just been writing and wheeling and dealing in the standard author stuff.
A children's book, impressive. Haven't there been numerous people say that's a really hard genre to get into?
Oh yeah, I'm sure it is, but I make lots of mistakes, so this will be just one of those.
All right, well, you gotta have just fun for you projects in between the ones that pay the bills.
And, I like art, and there's a ton of it in this.
That's excellent. I don't know if we mentioned it, that Joe's actually writing a story for my series that's coming out in Kindle Worlds in April, hopefully, if people actually get done writing the books. I'm getting a little concerned. I might have to make up a pen name and write a bunch of stories for myself, so there'll be some books for the launch.
Well, hopefully I'll have mine done. I'm doing okay. And I already have a slot with my editor.
Good. You could, maybe you'll actually make money because like you'll be the only one.
Right. It's a niche that needs to be filled.
That's right. It's definitely an underserved market.
Do you need, write a need.
There's definitely no traditional publishers doing stories for my Kindle Worlds. All right. News for me. Oh, I should mention Joe and I are in another story bundle. Yeah, did you curate this? You
did curate this. What a surprise then that you would end up in it.
I've been in several though, and I forget who you were in the last one too.
I did not curate the last one, yes. But we were together in that one too. Yeah, we sci-fi adventure is the theme for this bundle, but yeah, so I'm proud of this one because it was initiated because me and one of the other people from the very first bundle had a new book in the series that we put in that very first bundle. So sort of the theme of bringing back people from previous bundles was the idea here. And it's been going since Tuesday, last Tuesday. So and it's going in for another 2 weeks, I think.
All right. Yeah. So if y'all want to buy 15 books at once, name your price. It's a pretty good deal. Storybundle.com/sci-fi, I think, for another 2 weeks.
That's right.
There's our shameless promo of the episode. We got that out of the way now, so hopefully you guys can get some good information. Just my news, I started working on my spinoff series for the sci-fi, the Fallen Empire stuff. I was going to do a fantasy novel first, and I actually got it started, the third book in my Chains of Honor series. But I got the cover art already for these books. The guy is really fast, Tom Edwards. He's great. And my other guy is less fast. I'll just leave it at that. He's awesome too, though. His work's really cool. So I'm looking forward to it. But and because of the launching the Kindle Worlds thing, I'd like to get this series ready to, it's kind of a spin-off of the same world, some of the same characters. So have that ready around the same time in March, April. And I'd like to do the same thing I did last year, which is launch with the first three, I guess I launched the first two only a week apart, and then the third one like 3 weeks later, and I want to do that again because it worked really well. And I guess we'll talk about that some more in Lessons Learned of 2016. I will say that I'm debating on this one. Maybe you guys, if you've done a lot of YA or any YA sci-fi, leave a comment and let me know how it went, because I'm thinking about throwing it into that category as well as the main category, just because the heroine is 18 in this one, and it's very much she's still part of the family and wants to go off, and she goes off and does her own thing, but then she has to answer to mom and dad at the end. So I think it has a little bit of a YA vibe. So I'll be curious. I'm not sure if readers, how much they look at the categories. I'd hate to, for adult readers to go, oh, this is YA, I don't want to read it. And because I think most of my stuff is very accessible to most ages. If you're very mature, you might not want my work, no matter how old you are, if that makes sense. But anyway, that's my news. So let's jump right into our first discussion topic here. I'll let you guys talk for a bit and go first. Just what are some of the lessons that you learned either from your own work or from guests we've had on the show in 2016?
Lessons that I've personally learned. We've had enough people that we've interviewed in 2016 that have said that they had like a writing support team. That I've actually abandoned my use of like always asking for like beta readers and whatnot. And I just created my own. I call them the posse. Everyone that wants to is willing to help me out, and I give them copies of the book and say, hey, rip it to shreds, do what you want to do with it. And I always, and that's them. They're my backup support system there, and it actually has worked well. I've learned that the, obviously, as we've discussed again, the perma-free titles aren't, the activity is not nearly as much as what it used to be. Like I say, I've had numbers of downloads, in the last, couple of years, but I've watched that steadily decrease. And I have learned that if you have a bunch of different series, in my case, I have three different series, I've learned that if I cycle between each one, like if I pull my Bakken Chronicles book one, I make that, free for, let's say, a month. And then, the Amazon algorithms like it, and the spikes in the downloads, then I'll put it back to normal price, drop one of the other ones to free, and then I notice it does the same thing. So it keeps the interest up that way. So I've learned to try and sneak around the system a little bit there. What else did I put for my notes? I did my new schedule. Oh, yeah, my new schedule has started. Like I said, I figure, me being the schmo that I am, I figured, okay, if I just, better organize my time, I should be able to, and I've timed myself, I can actually write a 100,000-word book for me in 2 months' time. And then a mystery, for which is roughly half that for me, in essentially a month's time. So if I were to be able to do that, that would be four fantasies, four mysteries, eight total in 1 year. Can I do it? We're going to find out, because that's the schedule I'm now working on. And I'm a little behind, but I'm pretty sure I can make it up. So I'll let you guys know how that goes.
Cool. And how are the mysteries going for you? You have three of them out now?
I have three of them out now. I have the original one, which actually is still in Kindle Unlimited. I'm actually thinking about pulling it just because I'd like to be able to get that. I've had numerous requests for other formats to get that out there, so I'm considering it. I actually did one of those free promo things that Kindle Unlimited lets you do, and it just blew up with downloads, and of course that spiked with number two and three. So that's got me hesitating, going, well, no, maybe if I just leave it in there, it might actually have a better chance. I haven't decided on that, but yeah, my other one, the one I wrote for the NaNoWriMo, that I also deliberately wrote one for like a Christmas themed one, they both seem to be doing pretty good, so I can't complain.
Yeah, that's cool. And that is a nice thing about KU, is you can just do those free days once a quarter. Although I have found with doing perma-free, you mentioned setting them paid and back to perma-free, that at least now, back in the old days, it used to be really hard to, you had to wait for Amazon to price match. And then sometimes like the stuff distributed through like Smashwords might take 2 months before Apple actually updated the prices. So you can do the same kind of thing now. I noticed when I did I had a book bum on my collection that they got it back to paid after I made it free pretty quickly. So
yeah, I don't know if they further automated or else they've got their spider bots skimming the internet, all looking for any sort of changes there. But as soon as I made that thing, made it free in Smashwords, it was probably within about 3-4 days that Amazon price matched it, and all of a sudden the downloads exploded, switched it back to normal price there. And it was about another 2-3 days. And I noticed the downloads, or the free downloads, stopped, and I checked, and sure enough, back to the normal price there. So it's a lot quicker right now, at least for me anyways.
That's good. And the plus with KU is I believe you can still get page reads even when your book is free. I know people have been reporting, maybe that's not always the case anymore, but the last I heard, like if you get a book bub for your first mystery book, and it's free for 5 days. You might still get people borrowing it or reading it, and the page reads are accumulating. So you can actually make money on a free book in KU. Mm-hmm. Potentially.
Potentially.
All right, Joe, let me let you talk there.
Okay. Okay, I learned this year that even if I slack off on daily word count, I can still get a pretty decent creative output as long as I keep myself interested in multitude of smaller subjects. Because I put out four books this year, only four books this year. But I also finished the next four books. It's just that I am not accustomed to having that level of output, so my pipeline is a little bit bottlenecked. So if I had a better pipeline, I would probably have six books out instead of four. But 2016, for me, most of my lessons were learned because I was experimenting like crazy this year. I put out a book called The Redemption of Desmarest that was what I called a sudden release, where I put it out without any buildup or pre-order. It actually came out the day after the fans found out I wrote it. So that didn't do so well. Turns out you should probably plan a release better than that. But that's a lesson learned. And I put out Between, which was an experiment from beginning to end because it was cross-genre and it was a standalone. And it started as a serial that was composed of a bunch of discarded ideas. And while it's well-reviewed, didn't do that well. Didn't expect it to, but again, why not give it a try? And I did a self-funded audiobook I've mentioned that's not doing that well. But again, well-reviewed and people like it. They're just not buying it in huge numbers. And the children's book is in the works. It's not done yet, so I don't know about that. What else? Put out a lot of merchandise. None of it's done particularly well. Sensing a theme here. What else? Amazon.com earnings are way down, which would be not surprising based upon the fact that, you know, lots of the stuff I just said didn't do so well. But here's the biggest lesson. Despite all the stuff I said, all the mistakes I made, my overall earnings for this year are $13,000 higher than in the previous year. And it turns out between things like the German translation, which wasn't one of my releases, but it's doing pretty well. A couple of one-time story bundles and stuff like that. Other storefronts besides Amazon.com, like Apple, Google, or Amazon.uk. All of those were just sort of rising up as I was watching my Amazon numbers go down. So the biggest lesson, I think, also, I put Free Wrench out for PermaFree. That was another experiment, because I felt like PermaFree was losing. So I was just going to make it PermaFree until it fell out of the top 10 sci-fi books on Apple. And it hasn't yet. It is still, and right now I think it's number 5. And the only reason it's number 5 is because I have a BookBub that pushed Book of Deacon up to number 1 in the sci-fi fantasy list. So basically what I learned was the whole don't put all your eggs in one basket. I have so many baskets, I'm forgetting where I put them. This is a sort of situation. And, also this I learned is that experiments, they don't necessarily hurt. So those are my two big things are I shouldn't be afraid to experiment, and staying wide has definitely been a good decision, at least based upon the evidence so far. That's where I am this year.
May I make a recommendation for you?
Sure.
I think I have an idea for your next nonfiction book.
Okay.
What not to do that indie authors should you won't pay attention to.
I have often said that the secret wisdom is just having made all of the mistakes. Like, I'm running out of mistakes. I must be on target for a good run because I've just, well, that's a mistake. I used that one up and
still can't jinx yourself.
That's true. Whatever. That'll just be the next mistake. Soon I'll have the whole set.
All right. Well, Joe is going wide this year and doing well. I think I lost money on all of the non-Amazon venues. No surprise, because I put my Fallen Empire series, launched it into KU, pretty much wrote 8 books back to back. And so the last fantasy I released was like February of 2016. And I'm actually pleased that I've still continued to sell books on Kobo and Apple, and Barnes & Noble is still pretty good for me. I've had a couple promos in that time, but I would definitely say the BookBubs have been harder to get. So there haven't been a lot of promos. I think I did my box sets, both got promoed in the last year. But Amazon rewarded me for being loyal and exclusive to them. It ended up being my best year overall. And I wasn't expecting that because last year, 2015, was really amazing for me. So I'm actually kind of more proud of 2015 because I was wide with all my stuff when I did it. This year, I feel like I owe Amazon a lot just because KU is, you know, I said this on somebody's Facebook group. I was like, it's kind of like pushing the easy button after having done it the hard way all along, just because for the first time I had stuff that stuck for a long time. And months later, you know, I've concluded that series. They're still selling. What, you know, I'm used to releasing, you know, maybe a month or two, everybody buys the new book, and then things drop down significantly again, and you drop out of the top hundreds. And so that hasn't been the case with the KU series. And it's possible, too, that I'm doing space opera, so maybe that's just a little easier than my mashup of steampunk slash epic fantasy slash swords and sorcery that's not too neatly categorized. Although I have to say, I've seen some fantasy authors also doing Kindle and, you know, Kindle KDP Select that have really done well. I think they have dragons on the cover, as we've discussed. That's apparently a necessity. But a lot of the news, though, has been, if you kind of watch the forums and people's blog posts and stuff, there's been a lot of down news in 2016. Reports of a lot of people not doing as well, saying there's more competition. Back in September, there was kind of a snafu, apparently, where Amazon wasn't maybe, you know, I don't think Amazon ever admitted this, but people that get a certain number of page reads each month from KU were saying their page reads were really down for no obvious reason. And somebody suggested that they have this page flip feature that people were able to read the books in this app. And I don't know how to do it, so I don't have it on my iPad Kindle app. But apparently, if you read the book using it, the pages didn't get counted. And it sounded like things might be kind of back up to normal now, but a lot of people, well, not a lot of people, I would say a couple people, there have been cases where people have come out and said they've been kicked out of KDP Select or Amazon completely because their account was suspected of suspicious activity. It's, you know, Amazon's been cracking down on scammers and all these people, farm situations going on where people are bots or whatever are reading KU books. Just to go shoot to the end so that people get credit for the page reads. And I've definitely seen where somebody's posted a link and you'll look in the top 100 and just randomly on a weekend, there's like 30 books with titles that don't make sense and just black or green covers with nothing on them. And obviously those are scammers or just, they're just up there based on the page, the borrows and page reads solely. So a lot of people have kind of reported that 2006 was really kind of a downer and that their earnings have been trending downward overall. And, you know, I definitely admit my earnings have been trending upward, but I've been publishing a lot more books. At this point, I'm not even sure how big my backlist is, but I think I'm over 40 between my name and my name or my pen name for full-length novels, not even counting stories and stuff. So as we were talking about before the show, I don't know how well my earnings would do if suddenly I was only publishing a couple novels a year instead of 10, 11. I might have had 12 last year. I had a couple short ones. So that's kind of a theme with the people we have seen in 2016. At least three sci-fi fantasy people kind of came out of nowhere or just started publishing at the end of 2015 or beginning of 2016 and shot straight into six figures. And the common theme was they were all in KDP Select and they were all publishing like crazy, like multiple times a month. Sometimes I think we had T.S. Scott, I'm sorry, buddy, I'm messing up your name, back on in like June. And he was one of the guys that I'm thinking of that just kind of came on the scene out of nowhere in early 2016. I think he was publishing something every 2 weeks when we had him on the show. He was doing shorter fiction at the time, I remember. But if you look at his more recent stuff, I think he's moved on to novel length. So you can make it and jump out of there, but boy, it's a super advantage if you're publishing really fast and able to. And I have no idea how people who are not already doing this full time can write that much. It's amazing to me. I assume most of those people have jumped to full time now or are in the process of doing so. But as far as my lessons learned, Joe made more money doing the wrong things. Following his passions. I actually did all the right things, at least sort of right. You know, I think we'll talk about later. None of us really write to market, even though we've had people on and it's been super successful for some people. And I've heard lots of stories of people going from like making pennies or dollars a day to making four figures a month just after they did some stuff where they looked at the market and wrote in the popular tropes. But, you know, I've kind of talked about this before. I launched the first three books of a new series into Kindle Unlimited. I picked space opera. It's something I'd wanted to do for a while, but we kept having so many people on that were doing well with space opera or military sci-fi. I started writing it, and then Chris wrote his book, and now there's a ton of people writing it. But my stuff's not really military sci-fi. It's actually not that at all. So it's a different market, I think, slightly different. Even though we all in the sci-fi category tend to click every box we possibly can, like, oh yeah, there's some genetically engineered mutant dinosaurs in chapter 10. So I'm going to put myself in the genetic engineering category. So you see a lot of the books in all the categories, but yeah, just launching that book, three books starting out really was helpful. And I did a lot of things that I'd known to do from all the great guests we've had on that I had never been able to do very well with my previously. As an example, I started a brand new mailing list for the sci-fi. Right away, I had something free to give away to anybody who read the book, and I had the link in the back and they could sign up. And that worked very well. Surprise, surprise. Before, with my regular list, I just kind of had up on my site. I was like, oh, if you want news and to hear about new releases, sign up. So I think I have 2,000 people now, 2,000 more people on the sci-fi list that's only been around since May than I have on my regular list that I started in 2011. So yay, giving away a prequel in my case, it works. And as we've talked about before, I think the fact that it wasn't available for sale anywhere else was a huge incentive for people to sign up. I know in my case, if I see, oh, you can get this for free if you sign up for a mailing list, or, oh, it's 99 cents, I'm just going to buy it because then I don't have to sideload it to my Kindle or anything like that. So, and I don't really want to be on anybody's mailing list, but this way you get those people that are maybe not as eager to sign up for mailing lists. And if they hate it, they can always leave, but it was very successful. And also for that series, I participated in a box set that ran for 3 months where we all put our book ones in. So I think that helped keep things rolling for a while. I did a free anthology with a short story using the same characters from the series. So it's just like I was trying to do all these little things that in the past I'd done some of them when I could, but it was a concentrated effort in this case, and I really think it helped, especially launching into what was a new genre for me. Yeah, you guys have any comments on that? Any of that blah, 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 blah?
Not really, to tell you the honest truth. I mean, it works for me. I've been doing this sort of thing now. It's funny you were mentioning earlier that how Amazon has been tightening the news. Amazon, if you're listening, sorry, but Amazon is getting a little more strict with people that are closing accounts what they suspect is negative activity. So you always have to be mindful that you don't do anything that's screwy with them. Because okay, here's a question for you: these people that you've heard from in the forums that have had their accounts closed, are they able to get them back open, or are they just screwed?
Yeah, it sounds like in most cases that they have been able to get them back open after calling and talking and going around and stuff. And some of the common themes, one was they were doing promos, which I've done before. There's a guy on Fiverr, BK Knights. I think he only charges like $5, obviously, because it's on Fiverr, you know, and throws out an email to his list with like 100 books on it or something. It was always kind of good for... It was worth the money. Let's just say you usually made back the whatever you needed, 10, 15 sales to break even on a 99 cent title. So a couple people had seen that as maybe a common thing. But I think what it is a lot of is the scammers are also targeting normal books in order to make themselves harder to be found. Like if they just read the same 10 authors or 10 books over and over again, maybe they'd be discovered more quickly. And if they're using their KU subscription to read other stuff, and they might become aware of your title after seeing it in a promo like this. It's just that's some of the theories or hypotheses I've seen out there. But it is a little scary to think that, gosh, somebody, if you had a grudge against somebody, you could just, go scam read their Kindle, all their books in KU and just flip to the end. And, you know, so yeah, there's definitely something to be said for having some stuff wide. And for now, I'm keeping my sci-fi's in there, but I'm glad my fantasy's not, and I still will be launching new fantasy books wide, especially the stuff that's in the middle of a series. I'm not going to switch out on anyone, but It's something to be aware of. I know when I used to do blogging for a living, I used to make like 95% of my money from Google AdSense, and it was the same deal. I always wanted to make more from like affiliate programs and other things, but it was so much easier to make money over here with Google AdSense than with anything else, that it just ended up being your big winner as opposed to everything else.
And one thing I will say that actually works quite well for me is I've got my first mystery in KU. Mysteries number 2 and 3 are released wide. So, you know, let KU like build up the momentum and get people talking about it. And I mean, yes, I've got number 2 and 3 available on Kindle, but not KU. So far it's working pretty good. I guess what a hybrid release on that, but.
Have you had any pushback from your readers who came to you through KU?
A little bit. I've had some people that say that, you know, like I can just tell that, okay, I have a feeling I would get more sales or reads on number 2 if I had it in KU, but I'm trying to appease some of the other masses that are out there going, well, why don't you release the mystery? I mean, I'd love to be able to read it on my what is it called? The Nook book thing or whatever that thing might actually be called there. I'm like, tell you what, I'll release number 2 on that way. And I had a good response for number 2. So I released number 3 wide as well. So thus far, no regrets.
Yeah, it's a little tougher for those of us who started wide and have actually accumulated fan bases in the other places, because I have definitely gotten emails this year that are not too pleased. Why isn't this on Kobo? It's always the Kobo people. Mark Lefebvre, if you're listening to this, what's up with your Kobo people? They're like, I don't know, they care more. The Barnes & Noble Nook people don't email me. Maybe they're just used to having to buy stuff on Amazon more, or I'm not sure, but for some reason... Kobo,
For me, it's Barnes & Noble. I get some of the emails that say, dude, all your other titles are available on Barnes & Noble. I eagerly look forward to getting your mystery, and what do you know? I can only get it on Kindle. I'm like, sorry, all right, here. You've got number 2 and 3 out. Have fun with it. So that's why I'm debating when number 1's up at the beginning of February, should I yank it from KU or keep it? Because I do like the response it's given when I did that free promo for a few days. So I was like, I'm torn. Haven't decided what to do yet.
Yeah, it's tough to choose, especially if you do hear things about, oh, somebody got kicked out, then that, if you got kicked off Amazon, that's, for most of us, that's most of our income. Mm-hmm. And even if you're able to get it back, there's a scary period of time where you're not able to, you're not sure if it's going to work out. You know, I think that's a pretty small percentage of people right now where anything like that is happening, but you hear about it, it's in the back of your mind. And wanting to please readers and be on the other platforms too is always in the back of your mind. So it's hard to make everyone happy. You know, I tell people, like, launch into KU now and then gauge how you're doing after 3 months. And if it's, you know, if it's kind of you're not in the, maybe to stay in the top 100 list and things, maybe jump out and try it wide, and you never know.
Very true.
All right. Any thoughts, Joe, on lessons learned?
You were talking about you started a new mailing list for sci-fi, and then you had something to give away that was exclusive there. I've found, first off, as with almost every other thing, my mailing list is named after the first book I released because I didn't anticipate doing any other series. And I think at this point, splitting them off is going to confuse more people than it'll help. But I have found that with the giveaway, I give away short stories and I replace it once every few months whenever I write a new short story. And eventually when I do a collection in the series of short stories I will add the short stories to that collection in order to add value to the collection, so it's not just the novels. And I have found an inordinate number of people who would rather me just sell the short stories separately than have them in a collection or for free. And I was just like, I think it's sort of funny how you have found that having it exclusive to your mailing list is effective. I have found I get more complaints about it being exclusive to my mailing list.
That's interesting. I've had a couple of people that have asked, will these be available so I can just get them? You know, I use Book Funnel and they should be able to get them on their Kindle, but you know, it's more steps than if they just, Amazon has mastered how to just buy and it appears. Yeah. And it's an amazing number of people who have no idea how to otherwise put books on their ebook reader. And so maybe those are the people. But sometimes things work even though people complain, right? So yeah. Maybe they'd rather be able to just buy the prequel. Too bad. I want you on my list so I can email you all when Amazon kicks me out of their program and I need to start making money on Patreon or something.
Exactly.
All right. So those are some of the lessons, I guess, that we learned. Apparently, if you do all the things that you're supposed to do, it works. One of the reasons I think I mentioned before that I've never done the free stuff on my fantasy list is I'm kind of in the same scenario as you, where I have multiple different series for the fantasy. And if people came in from The Emperor's Edge, what do they care if I do a Dragonblood short story as the bonus? Hopefully they read everything eventually, but I definitely have people that are way more invested in one series than another series. So this was a way to start clean and actually do it right from scratch. All right. For those who are listening, who are not yet making oodles of money, but would very much like to make the oodles, we're going to kind of discuss, I don't know if this is going to be like a summing up of some of the guests we've had on and stuff, but strategies for doing well or maybe breaking out in 2017. I scribbled down some of my thoughts. Do you guys want to, do you have any thoughts that you want to share first, or should I go first?
Probably ought to go first, I would say.
All right.
I concur. I have notes, but I don't want to overlap yours.
All right. Well, you know, I think the big thing that we've seen this year, I already mentioned if you can publish quickly, that may be a big help. And you put out appealing products. I think the one thing I've seen in 2017, especially in this KDP Select, KU era, is that a really good package can get you a long ways. You know, at least on your book one. After that, people are going to continue on or not based on the story and whether you've gotten them into the books. But, you know, we've seen success stories with people doing the right to market thing. We've also seen some people that are not necessarily ready to market and just writing a lot. And I know that's not exactly what you want to hear if you're not a super fast writer, and most people aren't. You know, I've told the story before how it took 7 years for me to finish my first novel. Sometimes you have to hear about other people doing these amazing things to kind of motivate you to try to find the time. I mean, if you really want it, if you just want it to be a hobby, then there's no big deal. But if you're kind of dreaming of like, okay, I could do this, I've made a little money, maybe I could make enough to quit the day job, you know, I think you really have to figure out how to, in this day and age, to write more and get more out there. We've had Rachel Aaron on the show before with the 2K to 10K book. So if you haven't read that one yet, definitely a good one to pick up. Just talking about how to really make more of your writing time that you do have, you know, because some people may only be able to get 20, 30 minutes in a day. But if you're really ready to write when you sit down and do that, or if you dictate whatever your thing is, you might be able to get 1,000 words a day out of that time. And that adds up really quite quickly. And I think we've had people on doing shorter novels and maybe long short stories, novellas. Even though I feel like novels are still the preferred thing with most readers, it is possible to do well. So that's something to consider too, if you're just trying to think, well, I can only write X number of words at a time. You know, maybe doing some of those shorter novels to get more releases out there. And, you know, it's more releases for your fans, and it's also just more chances to kind of hit with something. You know, we all, even though Joe's over there doing interesting things that aren't to market and cross-genre, and I've done a lot of that stuff too. No, but you never know. That's the thing. The more things you try, you know, I kind of joked in a forum post. I was like, you know, hey, I don't want to write to market. I want to start the market. And, you know, you never know. It's possible, right? Who was doing dystopian with the indie authors before Hugh Howey did his thing, had his story blow up? And it's not like it wasn't a genre before, but you know, certain economic time periods, the dystopian stuff really catches on more than other times. And there's cycles with everything. And you never know, you might become the next person that puts out sparkly vampires and has that happen. But if you're not willing to kind of study the market and write to market, and just in case you haven't been listening and that's a new idea to you, we've had Chris Fox on several episodes, and his book is, he's got Right to Market, and he's got a new one out that we talked about like last week or something, that kind of studying the data and figuring out how to work the algorithms, six-figure author. It's another one you can go check out. His books are only like $4, so, and they're short and concise. But if you're not interested in doing that, and that's okay. Like I said, we've seen people do well that aren't the kind of cross-genre mishmash stuff. It can happen, you know, if you just have really good characters, a good story, and I feel like you might need to do the perma-free more, or more if you're in KU, just cycling and trying the free days more to get people to try your books. This is kind of the case with me with my Emperor's Edge series. I never had the right covers for that series. I have new ones in the works, taking a long time. And they were never really quite to market or quite on trend, whatever. So, but I've given away tons and tons of copies of that first book, you know, especially the first couple of years I was writing, and that was my main series. Anytime I could get a promo, I'd throw it out there, and, you know, people will try stuff that's maybe not quite what they're looking for if it's free, if it sounds kind of interesting. And I feel like if you're not going to write to market, you probably really need to have the craft side down, maybe a little more than if you're writing to market. You know, we've talked about this. You've probably read formulaic stuff that's just A, B, C, D, you know, it gives you the reader what they want. The romance genre is particularly, that's typical. You know, I know like those Harlequin books, I think my mom actually way back when wanted to write one, and they send you like a sheet. This is what you do. It's got to be like 55,000 words and this, and this happens. Because they knew way back then, right? They knew what their readers wanted. And so maybe as you could be maybe a little less compelling plot characters, that kind of thing, if you were giving them exactly what they wanted. I feel like if you're going to not do that, you really have to have the craft side down. You have to, or at least something about your writing has to be really compelling, whether it's the characters that you've put together, how you do twists in the plots, your world building is amazing. Whatever your strength is, it can really draw in your target reader. You probably need it more so if you're not writing to trend, which is not to say if you're really good at the craft, you can't write to market. You're probably golden then, right? It's probably the best of both worlds. And it's not like, I don't think any of the three of us hate the idea of writing to market or anything like that. I know in my case, I've never really been that into what tends to be popular in my genres. I kept waiting for that vampire thing to end. I was like, no more vampires in my fantasy. Why are these not back in horror where they belong? You remember like
vampires,
in the 80s and 90s?
I was so tired of them.
They were all horror when I was used to read fantasy. You didn't find them in the fantasy, and then they crept into the fantasy in the urban fantasy category, and they're just all over the place. You know, and maybe you hate dragons. Maybe you hate some of the things I love. I love assassins. Those always end up in my stories, but I'm not sure they're quite as trendy as vampires, sadly. But so I just, you know, you're going to have a little more patience if you're not going to write to market. And maybe you're not going to make six figures right out of the block, but that doesn't mean you can't gradually build up a fan base. You know, just every time you run a promo, you know, don't be afraid to make the first book free, especially after you have a couple more out. And you can do like Jeff is doing and just temporarily make it free. And maybe you'll get more mileage out of that in this kind of day where with so many people subscribing to Kindle Unlimited, those are kind of their free books. They don't have to go looking for the free books quite as much anymore, but there's still a lot of subscribers to the BookBub and some of the other newsletters that they watch and they wait and they check out the free stuff. And there's kind of a common, I think it's a myth a bit, that in the indie community that people don't even read free books. They just download them and never check them out. I think this is said by people whose free books maybe aren't that great. I'm probably insulting half of our audience. I'm sorry, your next one will be awesome. But, you know, because I feel like people download everything, they check it, they sample it, you know, they read the first couple pages. And if it doesn't grab them, then they have so many more options, they're not going to stick with it. So that may be more of the problem than that people won't try free books. Because I know I had a free just not that long ago in September, I think, book one in my series. And I got so many newsletter subscriber signups after that. I just watched them rolling in. It was great. And the only way you could subscribe to my newsletter, the only way you found the link was if you read to the end of the book. So, hey, it worked. People read the free book. So let me let you guys talk if you have any comments on that.
I was just going to say, we can't also discredit all the new people that are out there getting themselves e-readers, Kindles, and whatnot. Because, you know, I still do the computer tech stuff from time to time. And I have set up numerous Kindles. I have set up numerous Nookbooks and Kobo readers and all that jazz. And especially with the Kindles, I always get the older clients. Not that there's anything wrong with the older clients. The older clients go like, okay, well, now what do I do with it? I'm like, because typically it's a present from somebody else. And I go, no, let me show you what to do with them. There's free books. There's these books. There's that book. And I'm, of course, what books do I download for them? If they're a fantasy lover, you guessed it. So I'm showing them how it works. And they're like, oh, well, this is great. And so there is always people just stepping foot into the ebook world there, and thus far that I've seen, everybody loves it. So just because you've seen, you know, you think some of your books are dying down, yeah, if you can get, you know, those stupid algorithms from Amazon to pick up your book and, you know, spread the word again, it'll, you know, you can get a lot of downloads from it. And that's why I like to, you know, cycle through my, all my first series starters there, because it works.
Yeah, I gotta say, I have to agree, like, in terms of ways to break out, like, with most of what Lindsay said. Just, I sort of think about what I would like to do in order to help, just the lessons that we've learned from our guests this year that I can apply. Writing fast is something I need to work on. I think everyone should probably work on writing fast. And I feel like the key that is writing consistently. Like, not that I don't, but I feel like a lot of people will say, well, I'll wait until I have a good weekend or a long weekend to dedicate to writing, if they're just trying to get started. You know, then they'll maybe have a really, you know, they'll write 7,000 words in that weekend and they'll be very happy. But I feel like making sure you write at least a little bit every day when you're just trying to get started and trying to build up the rapid release, it seems like the way that you succeed. I think that's a thing that a lot of people are overlooking and something I need to work on. I mean, I do write every day, but I mean, like, just overall improving your word count, I think, is the number one thing. People will talk about how, like, self-publishing is like the lottery and you sort of have to get lucky in order to succeed. But if it's like the lottery, then every single one of your books is a lottery ticket and you will have a better chance at winning if you have more tickets out there. And I have to agree, too, that writing to market, something I probably am not going to be doing anytime soon, since every time I try, I wander off in another direction. But there's something to be said about if you happen, like, if you can find an underserved niche. We just talked about Lit RPG, right? It's a niche that's just ravenously expecting more books. Well, if you are the only one in that niche, if you have created the niche, that is the best of all possible worlds, right? You've monopolized the entire niche, at least until somebody catches you. So not that you can aim to do that, but that's the alternative to writing to market. And I guess the other thing is just Kindle Unlimited, again, like just things that I would do that our guests have suggested. I'm probably going to be putting out one or two Kindle exclusive books this year, just to put my toe in the water. There'll be technically an experiment into doing the right thing, which is a nice experiment to do. But I feel like, again, if you're trying to break out, you're probably going to break out in Kindle Unlimited. So that is a good place to target. I literally, this afternoon, I gave advice to somebody. They asked me how to get started on Kindle. And I was like, good cover, more than one release if you can, good blurb, and go into Kindle Unlimited for the first 90 days. So I feel like that's the way you're going to break out. And multiply that if you can for better chances to break out.
Right. And I was thinking when you said earlier you have only one book coming out a year, but in five different series. You know, I was kind of the same way. This last year was the first time I really knuckled down and just wrote book after book after book in the same series. And I would recommend that now. I know it's hard as an author. You really want to try other things. And I'm the same way. Like I wrote an Emperor's Edge novel. And then I was like, let's do these steampunk novellas for something to release in between them. And, you know, I tried a bunch of, did like book one and three different things, or at least two different things. I think that was like 2013. And it's really hard to gauge how well the series is going to do when you're doing the real slow releases or just launching the first book and then seeing. You know, I understand wanting to jump around and be creative. And some people say they get burned out just doing sticking with the same series. And I understand that too, because that's me. I've done that. But I think going forward, I have a couple of fantasy series that I need to wrap up that are just been hanging. And I've been doing that thing where you only publish a book a year and, oh, surprise, the series never really takes off or breaks out or does really well. It seems if you can get those first three books out there quickly and then more books, you know, while you're kind of riding high, riding the wave, it just seems like your potential for overall earnings is really good for that year and for getting more readers and kind of making it all happen quickly, if that's your goal. Obviously, if you're someone that's writing a whole bunch of books at once, maybe that's probably in the back of your head, you know, can I accelerate this? And I should say too that even though we've seen these people come on and in a year get to 6 figures, it's not like you can't do it in 5 or 10 years. You know, I didn't do anything spectacular my first year. If I hadn't figured out how to do permafree with my first book, like around the time I put the third one out, you know, I would have been kind of a pitiful first year. even with trying all this stuff, and there wasn't that much stuff in 2011. But so it can be a gradual build. And you know, on the note of the lottery thing, I don't think I've ever won the indie lottery. I've never had a real hit that's really stuck for a long time. I've had some stuff do well, but mostly that's on the back of because I already had a fan base that I'd sit there and kind of, you know, you just release book after book, try to get a few more people on your mailing list, try to get a few more fans with each release. And it's totally possible to get to the point where you're, you know, doing well, having a really great income. This is your full-time job, by just kind of gradually building it up. So I don't want to, you know, we talk about breakout, but I don't want to, I feel like I never really had a breakout novel. And yeah, I'm well into 6 figures. So it's not like you have to, you don't have to have that. It's great. I'm hoping one day, you know, I'd love to see like a movie made out of one of my books. That's like the dream. But
I think there's nothing wrong with,
yeah, there's nothing wrong with just quietly sitting over here and making money and getting emails from people like, wow, I liked your book. How come nobody's ever heard of you? I get those emails and I'm like, well, I don't know, but it's okay, I think. Yeah.
Yeah, that's a fun email to get. It's like, or the other one is when they say, you should make a movie. Like, oh, yeah, because you get to decide to do that.
Yeah, every other email of mine that says like, yeah, you really ought to, you know, this ought to be a really good movie. You ought to, you know, consider it. I'm like, trust me, it's considered. If you know a movie maker, by all means, you know, forward them or send them the book or let them know or something. But
yeah, because fantasy and sci-fi movies are so cheap.
Yeah, right.
You know, because all those CGI dragons and spaceships don't cost anything to make.
A friend of mine once told me I should pitch like whatever Amazon Prime and all the other streaming services are looking for content. And I was like, you should pitch Book of Deacon to be like a low budget version of Game of Thrones. And I'm like, it wouldn't be, the only thing that would make it lower budget than Game of Thrones is that I wouldn't ask for as much money for the rights to it. It's still going to cost a ton in costumes and location and special effects. It's not going to cost them any less.
Yeah, 3/4 of your characters are all CGI. I mean, what do you expect?
You have to be out there just riding the broomstick horse and calling it a dragon and look like some YouTube videos out there. All right. This is a good place to put in. We had a question. I actually didn't really tweet much about this show, so sorry if y'all didn't get to ask your questions. But Dale anticipated that we would take questions, and he asked, can you leverage pre-orders to break out? If so, how?
I'm not the one to ask for that, so I defer to you two.
You can leverage pre-orders to break out if you're trying to go wide. It's a lot more useful when you're wide. Because pre-orders, if you're looking to get a higher rank and stick at a higher rank, which is basically how you make a lot of money off of a single book, you have a reasonably long pre-order on places like Kobo, Barnes & Noble, and Apple, because they apply all of the pre-orders as day one sales, and that gets you a gigantic rank boost. Other than that, but the thing is, you still have to get all those pre-orders, and you can run a 6-month pre-order and get 3,000 pre-orders and then essentially have the equivalent of a bestseller show up. But getting 3,000 pre-orders is no easy task. So I would say if you're trying to break out with a pre-order, that you'd be doing it wide, and you would be working your butt off the entire time to get as many as many pre-orders as possible, and then hope that you stick. You'll definitely hit pretty darn high if you have a lot of pre-orders, but sticking is still a matter of visibility, and if your cover is good or your blurb is good and everything else that you're supposed to do to make a book sellable.
All right. I have to admit my answer when I saw the question was just probably not. But I do remember, I think I was listening to the Self-Publishing Roundtable. They've now retired their show, but there's one with Jasmine Walt. She really hit big this year, last year, and I think she calls it new adult fantasy. And she did a pre-order, but I think she was in some Facebook groups and kind of did some networking stuff before she actually launched her book. go look up the interview. I don't remember. But most of the time, I would say you're going to have a really hard time getting people to buy your book as a pre-order when you don't have a fan base and you don't, nobody's waiting for it. Nobody's read your stuff. I probably wouldn't even bother. Maybe throw it out there for like 4 or 5 days just ahead of time, just so you can get the also bots to populate on Amazon. And so you're kind of, everything's ready to go and gear up when you do your big push on launch day. But I think it'd be kind of hard as coming in out of nowhere to, unless you are in a, like last week we talked about the lit RPG stuff, or was it 2 weeks ago? I don't remember. Yeah, whenever it was. If you're kind of in a group like that already, if you found some kind of like Facebook group or some forum where you know a lot of people and you're writing to them, you're part of the audience and you're writing what they want to read, and you actually have some buyers lined up, I think in that case, you know, it might work. But if you're doing Amazon, you know, I wouldn't do a very long pre-order. For we've talked about it plenty of times, how it gets diluted. It's better to kind of try to get a whole bunch of sales over the first couple weeks rather than having them stagger and trickling out for 3 months ahead of time. So I probably wouldn't do it, but if you try and it works great, let us know. We'd love to have you on the show.
Yeah, and it's worth pointing out, this is actually a thing I ran into recently. Even if you don't think you're going to be using a pre-order for anything, I still think a couple of days of pre-order are worthwhile, because you never know how long it takes for a book to actually activate and get through a review on Amazon. And if you are planning like a launch, you want to make darn sure your book is available on the day that you have all your promotions planned, or at least all of your whatever blog, whatever you're going to do. You want to make sure the book comes out when you think it's going to come out, because there's nothing worse than having a whole schedule planned out, but then the day one of it gets screwed up because it was in review for all but the last 2 hours of that day. So a little pre-order just to make sure your release date is your actual release date is still probably a good idea.
Tell me that's not spoken from experience.
Oh, it's spoken from experience literally today. I didn't mention a thing that I have coming out today because I'm not supposed to mention it until my birthday on the 27th. But it was supposed to come out today. It's not out yet because of the lack of a pre-order.
I'm telling you, man, a nonfiction book. You know, us indie authors, we'd buy it.
It's true. Yeah. Oh, well, that's what this entire podcast is supposed to be. Just listen. Whenever you listen to me speaking, if you hear me say, I'm going to try something new, put that on a list, because I'll be telling you how it turned out, and it might not be good.
All right. Joe's doing it. Don't do it. Okay. Check. That's why we have so many great guests that are actually doing things right. But I think it should be encouraging maybe to all of you that we don't do a lot of things right and we still are able to sell books and make a little money.
Surprisingly successful, the history of Joe Lalo.
Well, there's a lot to be said. You said consistency when we were talking about daily word counts, and that's totally true. Especially things become a habit. You know, there's all those books, right? It takes 21 days to establish a habit or something like that. And I think that's true. But just putting out books consistently and... You know, even if you're not releasing 12 books a year, let's say you're doing 2 or 3 or 4, you know, if you kind of get them out around the same time, every 3 months or so, you'd be amazed. It doesn't take as long as you would think to build up a big backlist. And the nice thing about having a lot of books out there is you have a lot of different, eventually a lot of series and standalones maybe that you can promo. So you're not just trying to make the same series, trying to promo it over and over every 6 months or whatever on Amazon or every quarter. So, because I know when I got started, it's now 6 years ago, I had 2 novels that I'd written that were not in the same series that I had taken my whatever 7 or 8 years to finish up. And I was reading J.A. Conrad's blog, and he had like, so, you know, one of his posts, he shared his earnings and he did the screenshot of Amazon so you could kind of see how many books of each sold. And I was just like, oh my gosh, he has so many books. How am I ever going to have that many books? And, you know, I haven't caught up with him yet, but eventually you get to the point where you have a lot of books. If you just consistently keep writing and keep putting them out there, there's a lot to be said. There was actually just an article on Passive Guy. He was quoting some other article about how some of the people like Stephen King and that were making multi-million dollars a year and were really successful authors, like, what do they all have in common? Well, they all started in like the 70s or 80s, right? And they've been putting out books like crazy since then. So consistency is definitely something to strive for.
How long did it take you to write your first book?
7 years.
Oh, please. I started in 2001 and I published it in 2010. Gotcha beat.
Did you also play World of Warcraft for some of those years?
No. I
may have gotten distracted. There may have been several years where I didn't work on any writing at all.
Yeah, mine was just when I was sent out of town on different installs for computer systems and was bored, worked on it, but oh well, c'est la vie.
All right. Well, why don't we just really briefly talk about this 80-20 thing since I teased about it in the beginning. We actually kind of touched on it. When I remember distinctly when I saw that post from J.A. Conrath and he showed all of his books, because I think he'd made 100,000 that month. That was why he was like, here's my numbers, here's how I did it. You know, so he kind of sucked.
Month?
Yeah.
Damn.
So, but it was interesting to look at because there was basically like two or three books that accounted for like 90% of the income, even though he had like 70 books or something. So, probably heard of the 80-20 rule by now, the Pareto principle, lots of names. It just states that for many events, roughly 80% of the effects come from 20% of the causes. And if you go read the Wikipedia article, there's all sorts of interesting examples, and it comes up in a lot of places in life. It turns out to be kind of true. In business, and I think in writing, you know, I'll definitely look at my books too and you know, say that like 80% of my income comes from 20% of my titles. And for me, usually that's just a matter of new releases versus backlist. But if you look at your own stuff, it may be, maybe you'll find out that some of your backlist books kind of continuously do well, even though with little to no promotion, whereas some of your other stuff really falls off and doesn't do any sales if you're not doing any promotion. So when it comes to writing, you know, I think it's fine to have passion projects. And what kind of artists would we be if we didn't just sometimes do it for the love of it? But if you're thinking, gosh, I need to make the rent next month, or, you know, I'd really like to quit the day job, you know, if you already have a few books out, to go and kind of mine through that list and see which ones are doing better than the others. And maybe if you had one series that does well, you can kind of, you know, you don't want to be formulaic, but kind of do some of the same things or do the same genre again because it worked, and why not do it again? And if you don't yet have anything that's selling regularly, maybe it says that try something new and try to get to the point where you can do that.
Yeah, I'd probably have to agree. I mean, I think about it, I was like, yeah, it's pretty much my newest releases are within the last 6 months or so. Those are the ones that I'm getting, I would say, easily 80% of the income from. And the older stuff, you know, probably that's be the 20%. Or I would say probably 17%, and then the 3%, a real small percentage, print editions there, but not many people like the print editions anymore, but I like having them. But yeah, I would say it's always the new stuff within the last 6-7 months. That's what gets me the most of my income.
I'm sort of the outlier on that because, I mean, on a month when I have a new release, then most of my money will come from the new release, but averaged out over time, the first two books I ever released continue to be not 80%, but a remarkable amount of my income. And also because I have permafree, the permafree method, and I funnel to first books, then the sales, are highest on the second book and count down in each of my series. So it tends to be the further back in my backlist you go, the more money I make. And oddly enough, the 80-20 thing holds pretty steady for all the places my books are for sale, but it's not the same 20% of my books that are making 80% of the money on various places. Like Amazon is largely Book of Deacon. For a long time, for reasons I cannot explain, Barnes & Noble was, I was making most of my money off of my sci-fi. And still, as I mentioned earlier, iBooks, I'm still, I've stuck pretty high with my steampunk. And it's like the others do okay, but there are different 80-20 rules in different places. The fact that Amazon's the one where Book of Deacon is the most successful, and Book of Deacon, I just said, was my most successful overall, kind of lets you know that Amazon continues to be a big chunk of that 80% of income with its 20% of existence. But yeah, it's also, by the way, it applies to everything else, not just income. Like, you know, 80% of my fan interaction comes from two social media appearances. I am on almost every social media platform, but basically Twitter and Facebook are where not even 80, like 99% of my interactions come from. And that sort of taught me to stop paying attention to the ones that aren't useful.
All right. And I would say also, maybe even more important than in choosing the books you write, applying to this and paying attention to this for your marketing efforts is really going to save you a lot of time. People ask me how much time I spend marketing. I'm like, well, I don't know, 5% of my work time, maybe, if that. I really focus on writing new books and putting out new books because I've learned that's what sells the most books. And I've also learned with a lot of the marketing stuff, I've kind of figured out, you know, and you can use tracking links or whatever you want to figure out if something is actually worthwhile. Did it return your money and was it a return on your time? Facebook events and things like that, I've learned sell no books or next. It's so not worth it for how much time, you know, if you have to be there for 2 hours or 4 hours in order to answer questions. So I avoid all things like that. The multi-author box sets have continued to bring in money for me for not that much effort. Usually I'm just providing, here's my book one. And then when we release it, I send it out, you know, here's to the mailing list. Okay, we got a new multi-author box set. And I often get emails that say, hey, I first found you on the story bundle box set or this fantasy box set that you were in. So I continue to do those. You know, usually when people say, do you want to do one? If it works out, especially if I don't have to write something new. If I have to write something new, it better be a short story or forget it. But I found too, the short stories, putting them in anthologies with other authors and just making the anthology free. That's been a great way to get people to read the books. And again, whoever's formatting it will often use tracking links. So they can actually tell you, like, this is how many people read your story and then clicked on the Amazon link to buy it. So you can tell, was it worth it? And with the paid promos and stuff, it's kind of tough if you're stacking them. Sometimes maybe you just want to do one, just see if you can get an e-reader news today ad on this specific day. And then you can kind of see how many extra sales you got that day in your Amazon dashboard or your other dashboards too. One of the most powerful things we have as an indie author is the fact that we can get real-time sales stats. That's huge. You know, traditionally published authors have no idea till like 9 months later when they get their royalty check, whether, you know, how many books they sold and, or they're just guessing based on sales rankings on Amazon. So that would be kind of my other warning. If you want to, you know, if you're asking yourself, how do I write more books? How do I make more time? Be really careful of the time that you do have. You know, there's nothing wrong with networking with other authors and Facebook groups and on forums and things like that. But boy, if you see some of these people that have like 5,000 forum posts and only have 2 books out, that's telling you, you may be on the forums too much. Now, if you're writing 2 books a month and you have 5,000 forum posts, all the power to you. Stay on those forums and share your knowledge or share your whatever omelet recipes, whatever you're doing on there. So, I don't know. Any final thoughts? We've talked for about an hour, so maybe we'll actually try to wrap it up in an hour this time.
Omelet recipes?
I don't know what people do on forums. I'm usually just a lurker and not off on there very often.
I gotta say, I just have to agree with, like, and this is the reason that when I mentioned it started off as a bunch of bad ideas, is I had formerly, whenever I got stuck, I would just write. Like, people ask me, how do you get over writer's block? And I don't usually get writer's block, but occasionally I'll get something lodged in my head that I know is a bad idea, and I'll have to write it down to get it out of my head. But whenever I'm writing anything that is not word count for my books, I keep track of the word count anyway. And when I saw that was working its way toward 100,000 words, I'm like, this had better be something I can make money off of in the future. And I sort of feel the same way. Like, I keep track of stuff. Like, if I'm doing a ton of blog posts for I just recently did a guest blog, and I had to sort of add that 1,000 words to my word count for the day. So it's like, keep an idea, keep word count, universal word count, I feel like, is so that you'll know what the actual percentage is for your marketing word count versus your writing word count. And if it's pitching way in one direction, then yeah, you should be rethinking your process.
All right. Well, I guess we're kind of wrapping it up there. I will just kind of reiterate at the end that the best marketing thing you can do is to have an awesome cover, awesome blurb, good story. You know, we have all these people on doing different interesting things, and I love learning from what everybody's doing. But most of the people you see that break out or that just have some great success with the book, you go look at their book and like, oh, look, the cover's great. It's in Kindle Unlimited. And, you know, maybe that'll change in the future. Maybe KDP Select won't always be the thing for launching new books. But for now, I still think into 2017, it's probably going to be pretty big. And, you know, a lot of times those stories are kind of written to market or right what that genre is expecting. And, you know, it's a common thread. I think it's, and then a lot of the stuff they've done for marketing is like, oh, it probably helped a little bit. But they wrote a good book that was what the audience wanted, and that cannot be underestimated, the power of doing that.
Yeah, I can't stress the importance enough of having a professionally done cover. Unless you're a talented artist, don't try to make your own cover. There's a lot of people out there that you can get a good cover for probably a much more reasonable price than you think. You just got to go out there and ask.
Very true. All right, shall we wrap it up?
You guys
have any final words?
Don't we have that Joe, that lone wolf thing coming out?
You and I do have that lone wolf thing. It's coming out, should have been today.
So you're not allowed to talk about it.
This might be that thing I was talking about earlier.
Yeah, something about Amazon's, it hasn't gone through Amazon's vetting process. I don't know what, but it should be out shortly. There's 10, 12 of us? I forget how many there are of us.
This is one of those where everyone made their contribution on time a long time ago, and as a result, the details are way out of our head.
Seriously, right? I just know what day I'm supposed to promote. That's about all I know about it.
If you follow me anywhere, then you will hear about it soon. But
yes.
All right. Well, you guys really sold it there.
Yeah.
Whatever it is.
I need to refresh myself on it before I can try and sell it.
All right. Well, maybe the next show will let you talk briefly at the end and plug your book.
There you go.
Plug your mystery project. All right. Thanks for listening, everyone. I don't even have the show page up yet. I haven't started. I think this is episode 116. Does that sound promising?
It's somewhere around there, plus or minus two.
All right. Well, come on by if you have comments. Let me know if you had any experience with kind of plugging something into the YA category for sci-fi or fantasy on Amazon, and if you think it helped or hurt. You know, a real author would have written something to market that actually hit all the YA tropes, but as we've spent the last hour discussing,
that's not any of us.
So but come on by, leave a comment if you'd like to the show, or if there's anything you want to see in the future. We have some pretty good guests coming up in the next month, so I hope you will keep listening. And yeah. Hey, if you get a chance to leave us a review on iTunes, we don't have that many, so we'd love to have some more reviews. The 5-star ones are excellent, just saying. But, you know, anything that'll help people find the podcast, we love to get more listeners and really try to help people with our infinite wisdom, or at least the wisdom of our guests.
Learn from my mistakes.
Don't forget to subscribe.
All right. Thanks, everyone.
Take it
Episode
easy.
116, MarketingSFF.com. Have a good day.
So long, everybody.
Bye.